Hello everyone. Welcome to the first session of Ask Us Anything, where we solve all your queries around experimentation and optimization. VW Ask Us Anything is an opportunity to all our prospects and customers to get better at optimization and get any of their questions answered from our VW experts. Today we have joined by two VW experts. First is Nancy Thakur, who handles optimization for VWO. And another is Satyajit, who is product manager at VWO. Welcome you guys. And let's dive in into questions directly.
Sure thing.
Satya, take it over to you.
Yeah, sure. So there were a few questions here asked by Sharia Gupta. So one was a very back to basics question. So the question is how to get more visitors on the e-commerce portal. So it wasn't really, you know, specific to, you know, what they wanted in terms of new visitors or getting visitors to revisit on the website. So let me just touch upon both of these aspects here. So when it comes to a new visitor, before you go about trying to maximize the quantity of visitors coming into the website, it is very important to understand what the status quo currently is. So this is in terms of understanding the split between the different sources that are giving you traffic currently, and understanding the quality in terms of, you know, how they are performing in terms of the conversion rate, right? So more often than not, when you look at it this way, search traffic tends to be the one that has like a good balance between good performance and good quantity as well. So so one of the first things, if you're not really able to, you know, analyze the source of traffic in an organized manner and look at data, so search engine optimization is the first place I would suggest people go to. So there are plenty of tools these days, you know, that help you perform you know, keyword research very effectively. So getting your search keywords right on the web keywords right on the website, so that, you know, you get your search traffic coming in and performing to a good conversion rate is very important. The second thing that I would like to move on to is social media. So having a strong social media presence is like it's supposed to be, you know, you can't really compromise on that. So you have platforms like, you know, Facebook and Instagram, which allows users to, you know, redirect to your website in a very smart way, with very, you know, opportunities for a lot of contextual information in terms of how the experience can be personalized. So then you have platforms like Pinterest, where, you know, users can directly interact with the different products that you have, and, you know, they can even convert that directly without having to visit your actual website. So social media presence plays a very vital role. Speaking of social media presence, you know, it also gives you the opportunity to, you know, conduct competitions and, you know, giveaways here. For example, things like, you know, you can offer reward points for users who share a post on social media and get the maximum number of likes. So these sort of things, they have a chance to get viral. They can explode, and these sort of things give an instant surge of traffic onto your website directly from the platform. So these are very important. And, you know, speaking with a little bit of a social aspect in mind, recommendations and social proof, again, very important. So these are supposed to be very influential factors in the decision making of a user. So promoting and interacting with influencers in the public is very important. And, you know, having trustable review mechanisms and, you know, useful recommendations go a long way. So when we think about reviews, we shouldn't think of them as things that, you know, reside on the website alone. So they could be quoted in another platform altogether. They could be, you know, appearing all along with the search results. So these things are very important, and in a way, they should seem very trustable. And your recommendation system, of course, you can't get it right the first time, but you need to keep working on it and make sure you have a system that provides very useful recommendations. This is one thing. And if the brand is new, if the business is new and the brand that they've introduced is new, one thing that could be very influential here is display ads. You know, these help in catching a lot of eyeballs, and the advantage of display ads is you get to be able to retarget these audiences very effectively. So these are the few things that I think about when I think about, you know, getting new visitors onto the website. When it comes to returning visitors, it's a little bit of a different ballgame, I would say. So the first and most important thing would be, you know, making sure you make them subscribe to something. you know, notifications, newsletters. So they can be done in very smart ways as well. You know, you make sure you give actionables at possible dead ends that are out of your control. You know, the specific item that they're looking for is not available, or, you know, you're not delivering to that user's location currently. So don't treat them as dead ends. Make them, you know, give them some actionable and keep them, you know, engaged, and promise to keep them updated whenever, you know, it is available, or whenever you start ready to service in their locations. So these things are good ways by which you can, you know, get their contact and make sure you can retarget them at a later stage. Then again, email blasts, as old as it is, so they are still a very effective way by which you can bring visitors back to your website. So cart abandonment mails have been here for ages, and they're not going anywhere. You know, they still have extremely high conversion rates, when, especially when you combine it with an incentive, you know, and create some sort of an urgency for the user. And going past, you know, so when it comes to returning visitor, the first conversion is really important. So before the first conversion, they're not really aware of how good your service is, how good your delivery mechanism, for example, is. So the most influencing factor could be the deal that they're getting. So providing a good deal on the first order, or, you know, when they sign up and stuff like that, could go a long way to make sure that, you know, they get the first purchase done. And then, you know, subsequently, based on the quality of your service, they could be willing to compromise to return and look for a you know, a second transaction. One interesting thing that is gaining a lot of popularity these days is this spin a wheel concept. So in return for email IDs, they can spin a wheel based on which they get you know, random incentives. So this is you know, becoming all the craze these days in e-commerce platforms. And just to close things up, I just want to make sure I touch upon one topic, you know, mobile pages. So we are seeing the shift is continuously happening. More people are coming on the mobile device, and it's great if you have a mobile app, but it may not be the first way by which they might interact with you, because an app installation is like a little bit of a commitment, right? Maybe when I want to buy something, I would do it from a website first, and then based on the experience, I might think about you know, installing the app and using it repeatedly to make repeated purchases with the business. So just make sure the mobile app, the mobile page of the website is perfect. Of course, these days responsive pages take care of that a lot, but we have seen situations wherein, you know, the content is not, you know, it's not in a very aesthetic manner. There are things on top of each other which they shouldn't be. So it's very important to get these things tested and have a proper mobile website. You get that first experience across really well, and then get them returning on maybe the mobile app later subsequently. Of course, I just wanted to touch upon some general guidelines that, you know, these are like hygiene factors for any business, I would say. One most important thing is to, you know, analyze your competitor, especially ones who are performing a little better than you. It's not a bad idea to take a leaf out of their promotion strategy, the messaging and things like that, you know, things that play a very vital role in search. And, you know, their funnel structures and things like that. So it can give you a lot of insights on how you can improve your own strategy. Scarcity and urgency triggers are very important again. So we all know that, you know, getting the visitor to convert on that session is much easier. It should be preferred over, you know, losing that visitor for that session and getting them to come back and convert for you. Most of the visitors are lost when they go on to exit, right? So urgency triggers is a good way by which you can get them to convert right on that session itself, that visit itself. One other thing that could help in terms of getting them to convert could be a live chat support, you know, so that they are comfortable in taking the decision. They can get all of their doubts cleared by interacting with a human support executive. So this is one way to go about. Another thing that can be done actually is by using trust badges, you know, Google Trusted Store, not on secured website. Things like that, they go a long way in addressing some fear and anxiety in the mind of the visitor. So you need to make sure these are included on the website, as well as, you know, in any ad copy that, you know, it is promoted on, the offering is promoted on. When it comes to driving organic traffic, one thing that a lot of businesses generally miss out on is to publish good content in a very, you know, consistent way, in a fresh, keeping things fresh all the time, a lot of new content. So an all around enjoyable content can drive a lot of traffic to the e-commerce store. For example, there's a fashion store. It's not a bad idea to have some style guides in the form of blogs or something, where people are generally very interested to read about. And then from there, you can take them to the website to maybe shop a similar look or something like that. So these sort of things, they play a very vital role in getting people from a search result to that blog or whatever form of content that you have, and from there onto your store. Then one last but not the least, this point I want to talk about is the internal search functionality on the website. So visitors who use the search have a higher tendency to convert. In fact, the conversion rate of visitors who use an internal search, site search, is 3 times that when compared to the, you know, those who do not use the site search. So making sure this functionality is readily available is a great way of going at it. You directly get an idea of what they want, and you can optimize it in a way that you can address it directly. So these are what I have about the ways by which you can get visitors on your website, the new and returning, and make sure you have a good experience for them. Moving on, one of the questions we got was, what are the North Star metric for visitor behavior? So there aren't really specific North Star metrics. Of course, things do change with regard to industry here. Maybe, you know, the engagement time that people have might be the most important thing in a publishing industry. So things change to a good level. But three things that come to mind for me directly are, bounce rate, exit rate, and time spent. So these are three behaviors that are extremely critical. First and foremost, bounce rate. So a bounce rate represents the first impression of the website and, you know, whatever disparity it has with the expectation of a visitor. So this plays, things like, you know, the hero banner, the first thing that they see on the website. So it calls for how important personalizing the experience along those lines is. If they wrongly feel that the website is not for them, there's a good chance they're going to be exiting right away. And high bounce rate, again, it can represent performance issues on the website. So it is very important to analyze the site speed over here. So maybe based on some statistics around the high bounce rate, you can think about, rethink the way your website is built or how it is hosted and stuff like that for specific visitors, if that is going to be a problem. The second thing that I mentioned was exit rate. So where the visitor completely exited the website from. So it is very important to understand this. And when performing this analysis, it is very important to ignore pages which are meant to be exited from, the order confirmation page and, thank you pages and stuff like that, which have high exit rate, which are meant to have these sort of high exit rates. So when you are looking at other places where the exit rate is very high, you can zero in on behaviors that happen on that page, and you can perhaps think about how you can optimize it so that people and redirect them more towards a converting path as opposed to exiting the website from that situation. The third thing that I spoke about is time spent on the visit. So this is very critical because you need to. So it is not about a long session, a long visit, or a short visit per se. You need to have a good understanding of the average session time of a converting and a non-converting visitor, a typical converting and non-converting sessions time. So pages where maximum time is spent in each of these categories, you can have a rough idea of what behavior is causing this and categorize these sort of behaviors into conversion boosters or killers. So, you can have ideas to minimize the killers and get them going about doing conversion boosting activities. So these are one good way by which you can look at it. And it doesn't necessarily have to be based on time itself. So time is a good place to start. And then you can look at, number of clicks certain elements are getting, the page scroll on a specific page. So all of these sort of activities, they can all be categorized into conversion boosters or killers. And then you can ideate around which, boosting your, maximizing your conversion boosting activities and trying to minimize your killer. So there aren't really North Star metrics that you should look at. It's better to analyze them and categorize them the right way and try to minimize and maximize the right things on your website. Moving on, we also, I just wanted to highlight, there are certain behaviors that represent a struggle on the website. Concepts like rage and declick are all the rage now. So they effectively represent struggle, and more often than not, when we see rage clicks or dead clicks happening, it results in an exit from the page. So this is a good measure to look at to understand how much struggle visitors go through on the website, and then you can subsequently work to make the journey, the experience, a little better. So that's about it when it comes to the North Star metrics for visitor behavior. Moving on to the third question, what is the ideal conversion rate for e-commerce? Are there any benchmarks for this? Right, of course, there are benchmarks, because we do have a lot of data from the past. So I was able to quickly look at a little bit, and I just wanted to touch upon a few points. Of course, I'm going to give you some figures here. I just wanted to note that the conversion rate for e-commerce is generally lower than the global average conversion rate for websites. So into 2019, e-commerce saw conversion rates just below 3%, whereas the global average conversion rate for all industries put together ranges between 4.5% to 5%. So within e-commerce, what matters a lot also is the sector that the business is operating in. So what is being sold, the kind of product, the deciding and the buying process, they all of these play a role in affecting the conversion rate. So when we look at the conversion rate of different sectors, gifting related stores, health product stores, apparels, footwear, and sports equipment, they are the sectors that perform a little better than average, with some gift article specializing retailers even touching the 5% range. Whereas you have, stores that deal with jewelry, durables, consumer durables and electronics. So these are the sectors that are usually, a little below the average. Electronics is supposed to be one of the worst performing sectors when it comes to conversion rates. So this is the rough breakup of how it is between the different sectors. I just wanted to highlight a few more points. So the conversion rate, it actually, it varies a little bit on the source of traffic. Like I mentioned before, search traffic is still the king. You get that, why that happens. So you have people coming in with a lot of context in terms of what they're requesting, and then with proper, focus on their experience, their personalized experience into matching their expectation, you do have higher conversion rates for these sort of type of source. So display advertising in general has the worst conversion rate, but that again is mainly due to poor implementation in a lot of cases. So there are a lot of intermediaries that benefit from click-throughs and stuff like that kind of hamper the performance of this source. But there is, you cannot really take away from the fact that, there are good implementation of display ads in which business have benefited a lot out of. And then you see a shift to online. So this is a dimension of growth that people generally rely on. Year on year, every year, we have seen a 4 to 6% increase in the observed share of online and when compared to offline. So even if the conversion rate is going to be a little bit of a standstill for you, you definitely can rely on more people opting for online with time, which is going to result in a little bit of growth trajectory for you. Year on year conversion rate, you can't really put it down to a specific trend. So over the different quarters of the past few years, e-commerce has seen a range varying from 2.5% to 3.5%. So I didn't dig deep to find trends over here. Maybe I'll do that a little later and share them if people are interested. So I'm not really sure about, you know, the rhyme or reason as to why these sort of variations occur. But it is usually between this range, 2.6 to 3.4 actually. So when we look at this sort of a conversion rate, the most important thing here is to break it down in terms of an e-commerce funnel. So when we have 100 visitors on the website, roughly 43% of them, they go on to visit and view a cart item. And less than 15% add the item to the cart, which brings the overall conversion of that to 3%, the people who go on to buy that item. So it is fairly easy when you know, you break it down into these sort of different stages in the funnel. And then you can, it's easy, it just makes it easier to address optimization ideas at each stage. So each stage poses a different challenge, right, in terms of how it affects the conversion of visitors. So based on the drop-off of each stage, it will be easier to decide which to tackle first and gives you a more focused area on what to tackle, what problem that you're trying to solve. So what problem you're trying to solve, how do you get that? You do some sort of behavior analysis with the reports like heat maps and session recordings, and you get a rough understanding of why they dropped off. So ideas can be generated at this point to improve the conversion, which can be, you know, subsequently tested and implemented. So one important point here to look at is the different segments at every stage. So, you know, you have a focused ideation process for a specific set of visitors who may all have different reasons to drop off. So all this allows the business to have a higher empathy for different, you know, visitor profiles and have, you know, optimization activities that are focused for visitor groups, which gradually leads you to, you know, testing for these ideas and then using them the same thing for personalizing experiences for these visitor groups. So you do know that BW allows such streamlined methodology by which a lot of visitors have benefited from. So this is a you know, it's a tried and tested method by which you can experiment and personalize based on the performance of visitors on the website in different stages and then optimizing at each stage. So yes, that is it from me, Utkarsh, in terms of what I could answer to these questions. So
amazing, Satya. So let's open the session for the audience to ask questions. I see one question coming up. This question is from Steve. He is asking, based on your experience, what are the ideal places for on a website to run a survey to get a high response rate from visitors?
All right. So from the top of my mind, one thing that definitely comes to my mind is, like I mentioned, right, exit. The location of the exit is a very important thing that you need to understand a lot about. So, you know, an exit intent survey is a very good way by which you can get a lot of information from, because it is providing you valuable information. One of the you know, things you could ask that is, why are you leaving? What could you not find? What is the reason that you're leaving the website? So with that qualitative sort of feedback at that point, what you can tend to do is optimize for that page a little further. Nancy, do you have anything to add at this point, where you can run a survey to get a lot of responses?
Yeah, I think in terms of, you know, survey, there are multiple types of survey. So first, you know, having your objective defined is very important. And then it's, you know, it comes the question that where you can place it, right? Because I've seen if you place surveys on cart or checkout, which are at the bottom of the funnel, it could end up being a distraction. Yeah. So I don't want, you know, we don't want our purchases to get hurt. So we have to first decide what exactly is the objective and then accordingly decide on its placement.
All right. I think I don't see any more questions coming from the audience. So that's pretty much it. So thank you guys for giving up your time on, you know, addressing all these challenges. I just want to quickly give a shout out to Ask Us Anything sessions. We are conducting these sessions every Thursday. And the premise is to answer as many questions as we can in terms of, you know, helping you understand why, you know, you should invest in experimentation. If you are facing any challenges in terms of getting the best out of the VW platform, we are happy to help you in terms of addressing all those challenges for you. So yeah, so please keep attending these sessions, keep asking your questions. Even if you're not able to attend, we'll record these sessions and send it out to you. Thank you guys.